Before I start the lesson today, I want to share a couple of things. You know, since my book coming out and us being doing the podcast and different things, I've experienced some unusual growth. And the unusual growth are in the naysayers. I've had a whole bunch of people that I have defriended off Facebook. In fact, I have pretty well quit messing with Facebook except to up a little post, because there seems to be a lot of people in the body of Christ that have nothing other to do in their lives except argue, and they love it. And the last month or so has been, since I've gotten off of Facebook, they hunted me down and begin to email me, and they like the fish. They ask an honest question, and then you spend several hours formulating the proper answer, and once you do, your first response is, "Oh, really?" And then they begin to bombard you. I had one individual that I decided, I'm done talking to you. And I got 52 emails in 2 days from him, just taunting me. And we've had a good number of those, as well as we've actually had the Illuminati, or somebody claiming to be members of the Illuminati, trying to actually post on the KIB site. I have to approve every single one that goes up there, and I delete more than we post. Basically, advertising, if you'd like to join the Illuminati, simply email us at. And I'm thinking, you're not going to put that, you know, this crazy stuff. But I think one of the things that me was the kind of the straw that broke the camel's back. The second to last podcast we did, we dealt with false prophets, because some colleagues had been called false prophets on Facebook because they were bringing up the laws of God. And so my response was, listen, if you actually go back and study the Word of God, the ones that are called false prophets in the Bible are the ones that took you away from the commandments of God. And then I began seeing individuals doing posts actually using what Mary and I did on the podcast to validate individuals that I would consider borderline on being false teachers. And so the last session that we did, I entered that exhausted, frustrated. I had spent so much time answering frivolous emails that I didn't really have time to meditate in the Word that I should. And you know, with any time, and this is for any minister, you have to focus on your calling in God. If anybody gets you off of that, the fire and the anointing leaves with it. That caused me to be focused on the wrong things. I made some mistakes in the things that I was doing because I was frustrated and I wasn't preaching to the remnant. And so the last 2 weeks, I've really been looking at myself, praying. I have changed a lot of protocols that with emails coming in, students and partners first. Then if we have time, we can answer other things. But we're not entering into debates. We're not Bible. I'm not a Bible answer man. That if we see people that need prayer or whatever, we'll help. But that has to come third down the list from the ministry that God has called us to. In fact, I've been talking with other colleagues that are authors. And yesterday I was able to stop down at Skywatch TV and just kind of shared some with them. And I was able to get some wisdom how all the authors are basically share the same thing, that you have a choice. You can either be faithful in what God has called you to do, or you can let other people run your ministry. And so I choose where the anointing is. I choose God. And so I have changed some protocols about what we do. I have tweaked all of our mail servers. There's over 270 people right now in my spam folder that are automatically ejected because I will no longer even deal with them. At the same time, if they're a partner or a student, they're automatically flagged and brought to my attention so they don't get lost in the din of all the influx of emails that we're getting. So what I've done, I pulled the last sermon off of YouTube. Let's just forget that one even exists. This is, once again, Lesson 12, Version 2.0. And we're going to refocus. In fact, it'll probably take two or three, four sessions just to deal with Moses. Moses is pivotal in the Word of God. In fact, until the coming of Christ, there is no greater, more faithful, more honorable, or more powerful figure in all the Word of God than Moses. In fact, after you finish Torah, the very first of the prophets, and many consider, within Judaism, they consider Joshua the first prophet because he followed Moses the prophet. Joshua starts by pointing to Moses. The writings, the first of the writings is Psalms, which points back to Moses. And yet one of the things that breaks my heart is the absolute hatred, it appears, that many Christians have for Moses. And I believe if the Apostle Paul or the Apostle John or any of those were here today, they would be rebuking the body of Christ for their hatred of the, next to Jesus, the second greatest individual ever to walk in the kingdom. And so I want to look at some things, and so I want to build a foundation. I've got what may seem like wild rabbits to chase today on some things that I want to share, but they're not wild. I'm actually building a foundation for some things that we're going to get into in the next 2 weeks. Now, the first thing that we need to realize, now, God's people find themselves as slaves in Egypt. We need to understand with types and shadows in the Word of God that Egypt is a type and shadow of the world and the world system. The Pharaoh is a type and shadow of Lucifer and the Antichrist in the Word of God. And so I want to deal just for a minute, because this is so important. The powerful thing about the Old Testament is you can't understand the New Testament without a thorough understanding of the Old. All these types and shadows point to a greater reality that is in the New Testament. But one of the things that gets so many people off when they begin studying end time prophecy is this promise of God in Isaiah 56, 10 and 11, or 10 through, or 8 through 10. It says, "Remember this and show yourselves men, bringing it again to mind, O ye transgressors. Remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is none else. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and from the ancient of times the things not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand and I will do my pleasure." Now, Mary and I just did a podcast dealing with the fall feasts and how that the fall feasts are all about Jesus. And the amazing thing was God did something in Egypt when he set his people free. Based upon those things, he established feasts. Now, the only thing that had been established before Moses was the Sabbath. It goes all the way back to the very beginning of creation. So there was only one feast until Moses. After Moses, there are the seven feasts of the Lord. They are not Jewish feasts. They are feasts that belong to Yahweh. And so the Jewish people, every year that they were faithfully doing them, they were remembering what he did so they would be prepared for what he was going to do, which is the same for you and I today. And so even the Apostle Paul says, listen, these feasts are the shadow of Messiah. Now, Jesus is the substance of them and what he has done, what he is doing, and what he's going to do. And we find that in the stories of Egypt. We find that in the character of Moses. We find that in so many different places. In fact, I want to give Finis Deck's definition of biblical types. He said, "A type is a preordained representation wherein certain persons, events, or institutions of the Old Testament stand for corresponding persons, events, and institutions of the New Testament types are pictured or object lessons by which God has taught his redemptive plan. They are shadows of the things to come and not the image of those things." It's just like Nimrod is a shadow picture of the Antichrist, and it may even be more than that. There may be hints that the Antichrist himself will be the spirit of Nimrod entered into a man again. We bring that in clarity in my book. But as we read the Old Testament, all these things, we begin to find types and shadows that we find their manifestation in the New Testament. And you can't understand the full impact of what is real revealed in the New Testament unless you understand the types and the shadows and the foundations that God built in the Old Testament for the realization of who Jesus is and what he's going to do. And I think part of the reason why we have so many Christs presented in current Christianity today is nobody has a foundation in the Old Testament. And so if you just start with Matthew, you can end up making up whatever Jesus you want. I mean, even the Apostle Paul had to deal that with Galatians. Somebody has preached another gospel and presented to you another Christ. And so I think we're dealing with it again today. In fact, I would be so bold. In fact, I said this on our last podcast. If the rapture happened today, it would go unnoticed by a majority of the church. Let that sink in for a minute. They wouldn't be bothered by the rapture because it wouldn't affect them. That's why, guys, we need more time. But on the top of that, of more time, I'm getting ahead of myself. No, I'm going to wait. Egypt. Now, the people of God found themselves in Egypt. Now, Egypt was established by the uncle of Nimrod. That when you begin, I deal with, you know, I've talked many times before how the line of Ham had this esoteric knowledge most likely brought over from the ark. That this esoteric knowledge and the haughtiness that goes with it was manifested right after they get off the ark, after seeing the judgment of God. And it's in that family line that Babylon and Egypt both spring from. Cush was the father of Nimrod, and Mizraim was his brother, and there's indications that Cush helped both establish Babylon and Egypt. So there's this esoteric line. Babylon is the purest form of esoteric knowledge. The secondary is Egypt. And in types and shadows, Egypt is a type and shadow of the world's sinful system in which every man and every woman are born into spiritual slavery. We all wake up in this world ever since Adam in spiritual Egypt. We are slaves and imprisoned to the Pharaoh or the God, little g, of this world. And we see this all throughout the Word of God. When they point to the sinfulness of man, they point back to Egypt. All of us start in Egypt. Now, the interesting pattern that I see in the Word of God, after Egypt, now, Abraham came out of Babylon. But there's this new dichotomy that goes on, that in Egypt, when God brought his people out, they were established as a nation, as a people. Not as an individual walking with God, but as a group. And so they're brought out by a redeemer out of Egypt into freedom. And then later on, if they reject the ways of God, they go into captivity into Babylon for rejecting the ways of God. They were set free out of Egypt. They walk with God for a while. They begin rejecting God to the place that God has to judge them. And then God escorts them for punishment into Babylon. We see that with the Jewish people. Now, what's interesting on the main gate, in fact, the gate of Babylon, the main gate of Babylon is known as the Ishtar Gate. And it is still alive and well on planet Earth today. It's in a museum in Berlin. And what's interesting is all over the gate and the walls of it, they had, it's called the Dragon of Murdoch. That's all over this wall and all over this gate. And so you have the Jewish people walking into Babylon after Nebuchadnezzar conquers the southern tribes, and they're walking in, and they're taught always to look for signs. And so they start counting the dragons on that. And what's interesting, I was trying to find the exact number of dragons. I've got it somewhere in my notes. But when you look at the numeric value, there's only one word in Hebrew that has the same numeric value: hell. That they were walking into the gates of hell as they were walking into Babylon, judgment. And what's also interesting is the dragon of Murdoch is most likely a Babylonian representation of the Nechash of Genesis chapter 3. It's a place where the knowledge of the Nechesh ruled and reigned and established the gates of the city. You say, why are you bringing all this up? Isn't it interesting that two world wars evolved that came out of Berlin, but only doing, well, there's also, you have once the altar of Pergamos, which Revelation says is the throne of Satan, was brought to Berlin. Then you have the gates of hell brought to Berlin as the Ishtar Gate. You had three significant things happen. You had the German Theological Society had said that the moving of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit was not of God. Then you have World War I and you have World War II, all spurred from the same city. In fact, when it was from that place, a representation that Hitler had made outside of the museum where he had the major court that the Nazis used was based off of Pergamos, the altar of Zeus. Our current president, as he was making his candidacy for the United States, what was interesting to me is the first thing he did is he left America as he was running for president. He went to Berlin, stood in that place, and announced to the world that he was running for president. The same place that Hitler stood when he was announcing he was going to become chancellor. And then replicated it in Colorado when he accepted the nomination by the Democratic Party for president of the United States. Does anybody see a pattern? Guys, we need to wake up and smell the roses. Now, I want to ask you, where's the church today? I've already made the statement that if the rapture happened today, if the harpazo happened today, it would go unnoticed by a majority of the church. Where is the church today? I think we find that in Revelation chapter 18. Starting with verse 1. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened by his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils and every foul spirit, and a cage for every unclean and hateful bird. For the nations have drunk the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are wax rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out from among her, my people. We need to realize that most of the body of Christ is in Babylon in one shape or fashion today in all the earth. That none of us can raise up in pride and say, I'm better than this believer, I'm better than this believer, because the truth of the matter is, somewhere along the line in our theologies, in the American church, in the church in Europe, in the church in other places, we have abandoned the ways of God, and we have been judged by God, and we were carried off into Babylon and didn't know it. Many of us were birthed into Babylon, not knowing anything else but Babylon and the theologies of Babylon. And now we're getting mad because people are calling us out of Babylon and have the spiritual tenacity to point out that many of the things that we believe and the hyper things that we have taken far beyond the context of God's word is Babylon, and that the Laodicean church is functioning well in Babylon, but where it ceases to be the Laodicean church is when they begin answering the clarion call of God to come out of Babylon. Which I believe the remnant are sick and tired of Babylon. You see, there were many, even in Daniel's day, there were many that settled down into Babylon and stayed even after they were told that they could go home. They became comfortable in Babylon. But yet we find in Scripture that there are many that said, you ask of me to sing songs of Zion. And he said, but I weep and I mourn by the rivers of Babylon. And there are many believers today that are weeping and mourning by the rivers of Babylon. And the Holy Ghost is saying in this day and this hour, come out of her. come out of her. It's time for you to come out, go back and begin walking in your promise and in your promised land and begin to rebuild the walls of righteousness around you. That's why understanding the kingdom is so important. That's why understanding the task of the remnant is so important. It's returning to the ways of God. I also need to note something interesting that we find in Exodus chapter 1 and 12. You see, one of the problems of the American church is that up until recently, we were pampered by Babylon. Affluence does not empower the church. It creates the Laodicean church. Now, this jumped off the page. Now, the Pharaoh says, okay, there's more of them than us, which is another principle. How many know that only 10% of the German population took over Germany and they were called the Nazi Party? We have 10% or less of America right now running America and trying to take the other 90% captive. And so the Pharaoh was in the same thing. Listen, we got to afflict these people. We got to bring them down. They're mightier. They had become, the people of God in Egypt had become more numerous and more mighty than the Egyptians themselves. And if they ever decided to raise up, and so what happens? The devil's answer is, I've got to persecute the Christians to keep them from rising up. And they don't know that's the very vehicle that God uses to purify and enhance the body. Listen to this, verse 12. But the more they afflicted them, the more that Pharaoh and the Egyptians afflicted the people of God, the more they multiplied and grew, and they, the Egyptians, were grieved because of the children of Israel. May it be so in this day that we grow and multiply so much that we grieve the elite. Come on now. Sometimes we can only be purified by fire. I want to look at Revelation chapter 13 and verse 17. Because at the same time I'm looking at Moses and what they're going through, I see many of the things that we're going through in Europe, many of the things that we're going through in America. One of the things that we're witnessing on TV, guys. How many know that American news agencies are ridiculed worldwide for not telling the truth? It's nothing more than propaganda of the elite. Right now, Europe is being invaded. Now, they'll show us women and children, and how many know that the people that are really running from persecution need to be helped? At the same time, the UN says that 72% of them are single males. They're jihadists that are invading Europe. And now they're wanting to bring them to America. How many know that's going to change things dramatically? Especially now that Islam is being given favored status by our government. And even in Common Core, there has been a report come out of Tennessee and Kentucky both, that in Common Core, they're teaching the children there is Allah is the only God and that his only prophet is Muhammad. Requiring children. What happened to separation of church and state? Well, the only real threat to state is Christianity. The very thing that built it to begin with. But it's interesting, and I'm going to dig up this quote for you guys later on in some of the things that we study. But I ran across a quote, I believe it was in Morals and Dogma, but I've been reading so much of that in Manly P. Hall, I've got to make sure which one I'm quoting. But the quote went like this, that when you look on a Masonic altar, there are three books. You have the Tanakh, you have the whole Bible, and you have the Quran. So there's three books. And it says two of them are lies and one of them is real. So embedded within Freemasonry is an affinity toward Islam from the very beginning, whether you're into the Shriners or not. Because it stems from Babylon and it has the doctrine of Babylon interwoven into it that they can work with. But let's look here in Revelation chapter 7, starting in verse 13. And one of the elders answered and said unto me, What are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, They are which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore are they before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. How many know that sounds really good right there? And they shall hunger no more, neither shall they thirst any more, or neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of water, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Now what's interesting, what stands out, they're coming out of persecution, and it says, they have made their robes white. Now Adam Clark brings up this point, because some look at that and say, oh, that just means they were saved. That's just the righteousness of Jesus. Well, yes and no. Let's look at this from Adam Clark's perspective. And they washed their robes, have obtained the pardon and purity through the blood of the Lamb. Their white robes cannot meet the righteousness of Christ, for this cannot be washed and made white in his own blood. In other words, that would have represented the righteousness of Christ was first filthy and then made clean. So it can't represent that. This white linen is said to be the righteousness of the saints, Revelation 19:8, and this is the righteousness in which they stand before the throne. Therefore, it is not Christ's righteousness, but it is a righteousness wrought in them by the merit of his blood and the power of his spirit. Now, I want to read this again out of the New American Standard Version so that you really understand what they're saying here in quoting what Adam Clark did in Revelation 19. Let us rejoice and be glad and give glory unto him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. His bride has made herself ready. Has made herself ready. She's not waiting for someone else to do it. She has made herself ready. Bride, are you making yourself ready? Are you just sitting down there in Babylon, partying in Babylon? Or are you making yourself ready to get out of there and to be with your bridegroom? Going on, it was given to her to clothe herself in fine linen, bright and clean, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. You see, here's one of the things that I believe that salvation, getting saved, is solely a work of Jesus. It's what he did for us on the cross. But Jack, let me tell you something. If you got saved, what you do after that has to be transformed to represent the one who saved you. If your salvation does not change you, but it attempts to save to change God, you're not saved and you're not dealing with the God of the Bible. It's like putting on the armor of God, that breastplate of righteousness. Now, that's the righteousness of Christ you're putting on. But let me tell you something. If you put that on, it better start affecting you. It ought to change how you feel and what you do. You better start acting out of that which you have put on. You're supposed to be putting on Christ. Well, if you've put on Christ, Christ always transforms that which he has put on. And we have transformed-less saints. That's an oxymoron in the kingdom of God. Now, I want to read some notes out of the Life Application Bible. It says, this is the culmination of all human history, the judgment of the wicked and the wedding of the Lamb and his bride, the church. The church consists of all faithful believers from all time. The bride's clothing stands in sharp contrast to the gaudy clothing of the great prostitute of Revelation 17 and 4 and 18 and 16. The bride's clothing represents the good deeds of the believers. These good deeds are not done by believers to their merit, but they reflect the work of Christ to save us. And guys, let me tell you something. We're going to have to begin opening our eyes here. We need to understand that the work of iniquity in the lives of people manifest in their attitudes, what they say, what they do, where they go. If that is true, then the life of Christ in us must change what we say, what we think, where we go, and what we do, if we're still being influenced by Babylon and moving in iniquity, we're running around in the great prostitute's gaudy garbs, calling it the kingdom of God. When you study the book of Revelation, there she is drunk on the wine of the saints. And let me tell you something. I think part of the reason that I've been so overcome, if you will, by all these people that are trying to attack and argue is because they're drunk on the wine of Babylon and they just live to argue. I'm not messing with you. You're in another kingdom, and I will not be a part of it. God has called me to speak and to teach to the remnant and the remnant alone. I'm not calling people that are embedded into the whore and trying to convince them they're part of that instead of the kingdom of God. There is a gaudiness and a haughtiness and a drunkenness. They get high doing these things.
That's it.
If you could see some of the posts that I have deleted, if you could see some of the emails that I've, some of them coming from the mouths, if you will, of so-called believers was profane. It spewed the filth of Babylon. Denying the power, portraying that they're members of the body of Christ when all they are is Babylon with their gaudy garments. That's why I'm not messing with it anymore. I'm not. You know, when you enter your 50s, you realize how short life is. I got a whole lot more of my life behind me than I have ahead of me, and I'm not going to be controlled by the peanut gallery anymore. And if you don't have anything to do but to email me with ridicule 52 times in one day, number one, you need to get a life. And number two, you better get right with God because the Holy Spirit doesn't cause people to do that. That's another agenda, another kingdom, and you're drunk on the wine of Babylon. And if you're not careful, you're going to burn eternity in hell. The whole time claiming that you were a believer and telling the world this is the way that Jesus acts. He does not. I'm still mad this morning, but it's all right. The true sign of the work of Messiah in an individual's life as they begin to walk righteously and doing righteous acts in this filthy and perverse world. If you don't have that kind of fruit, your deeds reveal who you serve. Now, guys, although we are not saved through works, righteous works are a sign of those that have been redeemed. And it's fruit and not granola. The nuts, fruits, and flakes, you know. Spiritual fruit. And yes, the spiritual fruit of abiding in Christ are the fruit of the Holy Spirit. But the entire Bible is full of other fruit in the way it's manifested in righteous deeds. Now Christ, when we look at Christ, when we look at Moses. Moses is one of the most perfect type and shadow of Christ in the entire Old Testament. And so when I see statements on Facebook, this one guy, actually his name was Jesus Conquered Moses. Babylon. That's drunk theology. I want to read from A.W. Pink on Moses as being the perfect type and shadow of Christ. Moses was the type of Christ. Moses became the adopted son of Pharaoh's daughter, so legally he had a mother but no father. Interesting. Thus typifying our Lord's miraculous birth of a virgin. During infancy, his life was endangered by evil designs of the ruler. Like Christ, his early life was spent in Egypt. Later, he renounced the portion of royalty or position of royalty and refused to be called the Pharaoh's, the son of the Pharaoh's daughter, he who was rich for the sake of his people became poor. What are we told in Colossians? That he left all that and became and humbled himself as a servant, just like Moses did. He emptied himself of all those things. The perfect type and shadow. Before he commenced his life work, a long period was spent in Midian in obscurity. Here he is, receives a call and a commission from God to go deliver his brethren out of their terrible bondage. The credentials of his mission were seen in the miracles which he performed. Though despised and rejected by the rulers in Egypt, he nevertheless succeeded in delivering his own people. Subsequently, he became the leader and head of all of Israel. In character, he was the meekest man in all the earth. In all God's house, he was faithful as a servant. Why are we ridiculing someone that who is known as the faithful servant of God? Even in the book of Revelation, he is earmarked the faithful servant of God. In the wilderness, he sent 12 spies out into Canaan as our Lord sent 12 apostles to preach the gospel. He fasted for 40 days. He went into the presence of God. He fasted. Jesus went into the wilderness for 40 days. On the mound, he was transfigured so that the face of the skin of his face shone. He acted as God's prophet to the people, the people's intercessor before God. He was the only man mentioned in the Old Testament that was a prophet, priest, and king. He was the giver of the law, the builder of the tabernacle, the organizer of the priesthood. His last act was to bless the people as our Lord's last act was to bless his disciples. Even what was the first miracle of Moses? Turning the Nile into blood. What was the first miracle of Jesus? Turning water into wine. Blood and wine are synonymous within the mind of the Jew when looking for prophetic signs. Moses said, when the Messiah comes, he's going to be just like me. Moses came to give the law. Jesus came to write the law on our hearts. Oh. Moses and the ministry of Jesus are connected in the body of Christ today. Now I want to read this out of Hebrews chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Wherefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus Christ, who was faithful to him that appointed him, as also Moses was faithful in all his house. Now, in Hebrews, he's showing the greatest character, the greatest person in the Old Testament that walked with God, and he's showing the superiority of Christ. But at the same time, after Christ, he's saying, listen, nobody comes closer than Moses to Jesus. And he's the type and shadow of what Jesus was supposed to be. For this man was counted worthy of more glory than Moses, inasmuch as he who has built the house has more honor than the house. For every house is built by some man, but he that builds all things is God. And Moses verily was faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which are to be spoken after. What was the things to be spoken after? Jesus. Come on. Moses was the greatest Old Testament reflection possible of Christ. But Christ is a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold steadfast the confidence and rejoicing of hope firm to this end. Now, Dake says about this, for a testimony of those things which were to be spoken after, the law of Moses and some of his prophecies testify and typify the suffering of Christ and other gospel truths which are to be spoken later when Messiah should come. They looked at Moses, and they were to find someone who would lay down his life, who would give everything he had for the sake of God's people. So is it not ridiculous to say how Jesus came to conquer and do away with Moses, do away with the only example of what he's supposed to be so that we can compare him to verify that he is the Messiah. Now, Moses is not only a type of the Messiah's first coming, he's also a type of his second coming. Revelation 11, 3 through 9. And this is talking about the two witnesses. I will give power unto my witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth. And if any man will hurt them, fire proceedeth out of their mouth and devour their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed. These have power to shut heaven, that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood, and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will. So the plagues that God used by Moses that we're going to get into the next time not only were to bring judgment. Oh, it did a lot of things. It brought judgment. It wiped out all the prosperity that enslaving God's people had brought. But it also brought judgment against the gods of Egypt. The gods of Egypt are once again going to rise again, and we're going to see that. In fact, some have speculated that Moses might be one of the two witnesses, but he's dead. He died. The Bible records he died. Not only did he die, but Michael, the archangel, and Lucifer had to debate over the body of Moses. The Bible says it is appointed unto man once to die. Many, I believe, probably the most accurate that we could say is most likely going to be Elijah, who shut up the heavens, and Enoch. You know, what's bewildering about Enoch, I've heard people use Enoch as an example of the pre-tribulation rapture. But when you actually look at who Enoch is and when he's going to come back, he was such a unique character, he was pulled out to come back during the tribulation. Just saying. Now, Brother Mike, are you preaching against a pre-tribulation rapture? No, I'm not. I believe it is pre-wrath. I definitely believe it is pre-millennial. I look at all millennialism and I go, there ain't no way. But, guys, and here's the thing. Walter Martin said years ago, he prays for pre and he prepares for post. You see, if I believe that I'm going to go through part of the tribulation period and I'm surprised by pre-trib, I've lost nothing. I have lost nothing. I'm going to leave behind some food and some supplies, maybe it'll end up in the hands of some saints that are living through the tribulation period. But what happens if I'm surprised by tribulation? How far are you going to make it? And there's some historical things that we can set with this. You see, along with the pre-tribulation rapture, which is a part of dispensationalism that really, although you can find maybe hints of it at times over the centuries, it really didn't become a strong position until the 1800s with dispensationalism. But they also equipped it as a part, you know, they twinned it with, accept Jesus now so that you don't have to go through anything. You're going to get out of here before the things get bad. Not until recently have they changed that position. So before World War II, evangelicals from America flooded Europe preaching, you don't have to worry about anything except Jesus. You're not going to have to go through anything because the rapture will have for things get too bad. Most of them were killed during World War II. So much so that Huntington Boom basically begged evangelicals quit doing that practice. Corey Ten Boom, is that what I said? Go, Corey. Oh, Corey, okay. Sorry, Corey. We also have, and this is historical, when communism took over China, all pre-tribbers, Christians in China, were killed by the communists because Jesus was going to get them out of there before it got too bad. All those that believed in mid or post-trib, They looked, and when Jesus says, you know, when you see the abomination, flee to the hills. And so all those Christians flee to the hills, and they're the reason Christianity still exists today in China. And the truth is, we don't know when the tribulation period is going to start. We don't know how bad things are going to get before, so it's better to be prepared for post and be surprised by pre. Now, if pre happens, guys, I am not going to be griping on the way up. You know, I saw one time a cartoon, this guy had himself chained to chairs and everything else. And he says, I don't care if it's pre or not, I'm staying here halfway through it, you know. Not me. When the Lord says, yo, I'm going to go. But I'm not going to spend my time fighting believers on when we're going to end the race. I'm trying to equip believers so that we can finish the race. And my blessed hope is finishing the race and the return of the Lord in his perfect timing to take care of the Antichrist and to establish his rule and reign for 1,000 years. God is going to have his Sabbath on the earth. So let's quit fighting about where the finish line is and worrying about equipping everybody to get across the finish line. Now, Adam Clark says about shutting up the heavens, he says, as Elijah did, turning into blood, he said, as Moses did in Exodus 7, 19 through 25, they have power to afflict the land with plagues similar to those that were afflicted on the Egyptians. So even in the second coming, what we see Moses doing is a reflection of Christ. Even after he delivers them and brings them to Mount Sinai, only a free people can receive the law of God. When Jesus comes back and rules and reigns from Jerusalem, the prophet Isaiah tells us that the Torah of God, the law of God, will flow into the lands as a river from the throne of God. Do you see the similarities? If we're doing Torah before, we're going to do Torah after. How about doing some Torah now? Because it's all about the kingdom. It's all about moving in God's ways. And it's the only thing in existence to show us what's of Babylon and what's of God. Now, Christ is the perfect, he is the example of how to walk in the commandments of God. Not the rabbis, not some preacher somewhere, but Jesus himself. When you read the Gospels, observe how he keeps the things of God and learn to allow his Holy Spirit to work in you to walk in them the same way. You can't say you're following Christ and fight against the law of God. The two don't work together. It's oil and water. Now, let's deal with the fire, because I found this interesting. It's fire. Remember in Genesis 3, we documented that the Nehesh was a seraphim. He was this flaming serpent. And so when he got into the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that tree blazed with fire. So now we have Moses in Exodus 3, 1 through 6. God appears to him in a burning bush. There is no coincidence that it was a bush. Just like there's no coincidence that Jesus died on the cross, which was considered a tree. The Nehesh started it in a tree. God finished it in a tree. I mean, when you start connecting the dots, just this gets fun. And so we see the Nehesh. Now, he makes this entire tree flame in his presence. But when Moses first confronts or is confronted by God, it's a little bush that's on fire. You see, God doesn't have to show out to get his point across. Let's pick up here in verse 1 of Exodus chapter 3. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock on the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush, and he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. This is much the same way that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was not consumed by the Nehesh. And when the Lord saw, he turned aside to see. God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes off thy feet, for the place whereon thou standest is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of Abraham, the God of I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Now, there's so many interesting things here. Why did God have him take off his sandals? Holy ground. But there's also another kingdom purpose. Earth can hold the anointing of God. God said, you know what? Your sandals are insulating you from the anointing that I need to release in your life while you're in my presence. Take off your feet and let... Because what's your body made of? Earth and water. And God just added fire. The fire of God came into him and allowed him to do what he was supposed to do. Which is contrasting the fire of the Nakesh and what it did in the hearts of men. This is going to sink in here in a little bit. Now, later on, God delivers his people. Moses, I can imagine Moses, I'm going to take you to Mount Sinai. Guys, you got to see this bush. I mean, I went up there, and God, this is where I got there. I want you to go where God dwells. I want you to see the burning bush. And I want you to see where I got my commission, because this is the God. He appeared to me in this bush. Little fire in this bush, awesome thing, wasn't consumed. But we find in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 18 through 21, when God appeared to them on Mount Sinai. Now he's contrasting it to Mount Zion. But I want you to just get the crux of this. Ye have not come into a mountain that might be touched, and that burned with fire, nor with blackness and smoke and tempest, and the sound of the trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them any more, for they could not endure that which was commanded. And if so much as a beast touched the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. So terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly feared and quaked. So here Moses said, come on guys, come on up to the mountain. We're going to mikvah. We're going to wash for 3 days, representing 3 days that Christ was in the grave, so that we can go meet with God. He's expecting the little fire that was on top of the mountain and this burning bush, and God sets the entire mountain on fire. Says, just so you get the point, you came out of a place where the Nakesh ruled and reigned and brought his fire in the minds of men. So as I'm getting ready to give you my law, let me really show you my fire. And it was such a powerful sight. Now this is the Moses that was not only commissioned by God, but he went, he called down plagues, he took his rod, he parted the Red Sea. This same Moses freaked out at when God says, let me go ahead and show you a little bit about my fire. The entire mountain flamed and the earth shook. How many know the Nakesh has nothing on Yahweh? So while the mystery religions are scouring the earth and are clamoring for the knowledge and the fire of the Nakesh, which one of the types and shadows within the mystery religions of the Nakesh is Prometheus, who was judged because he gave the fire of the gods, which wasn't how to rub two sticks together and create fire. It's the fire in the minds of men that when the knowledge of good and evil infects men, they become consumed with becoming gods and enslaving those around them. That's the very heart of Mystery Babylon. They get drunk on it. So God contrasts that with the fire on the mountain. Now, why is that so important? How many know that there was just within 40 days after the resurrection, there was something called Pentecost that happened when the fire of the Holy Ghost fell. Now, as a young Baptist boy that spent a lot of time in the Old Testament, I thought the day of Pentecost was a new institution that was a new festival to mark when the Holy Spirit was given. But see, the day that Almighty God met with them around Mount Sinai, 50 days, that first time that appearing that freaked Moses out was the very first Shavuot. It was the very first Pentecost. The fire of God gave the commandments of God to men. It was established in the fire of God. Now, 50 days, Penta, 50 days, thank you, after the resurrection, we have the fire that was really the manifested presence of the Holy Spirit on that mountain. Tongues of fire came on men, empowering them to live the commandments of God so that they would be a witness of Jesus in the earth. The Holy Spirit is not going to empower you to do something that He's already told you in the Word not to do. He's only going to empower you to do what He's told you to do. And it will flow from Genesis to Revelation. I'm going to end this with one last thing. Remember when Moses said, "Show me your glory"? And God says, "You can't really see it and live." So He put him in the cleft of the rock and covered him up with His hands so they can only see in the hind part of God. Do you know that when you actually read the text, God basically says, "You're going to see it, but not right now." You see, there was a time during Tabernacles that Jesus took three of His disciples up to Mount Hermon, the very place where the watchers came and decided to create the Genesis 6 experiments. It was the same mountain where the mouth or the gates of hell resided. It was the same mountain that had the fortress of Nimrod on it. He stood on ground zero of all the evil, if you will, that had befallen since Genesis 6. And the Bible said that He was transfigured in all His glory. Who showed up out of heaven to see His glory? Moses and Elijah. God keeps His promises, guys. You're going to see it, but right now I just got to put you in the cleft of the rock. And you're going to come up with me later on just for a minute, just for a day or two. Because Jesus is Yahweh Elohim come in the flesh. So here we have a character in the Word of God that was so precious to God that God said, "You're going to see my glory in the earth," and then brought him back to the earth on Mount Hermon to witness the transfiguration of Christ. And now you're going to badmouth him and badmouth what God did through him. Can you see how moronic things have become in the body of Christ? The Bible tells us in Revelation that they're going to sing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. It's a duet. The perfect type and shadow and the real. And when you compare them, you see the glory of who Christ is. Guys, Moses came to help establish the laws of the kingdom. Jesus comes to empower the kingdom and to empower the laws. The prophets tell us in Jeremiah 33 or 44, I can't remember now. This is part of the promise of the Brit Hadashah, the new covenant. He said, "I'm going to write my law upon your hearts." Why would he do a supernatural act that required the cross to do something on our hearts that he did away with? Or have we been misled by Babylon so that we're rendered ineffective? And because of that, we cannot distinguish between the great whore of Babylon and the bride. Something to make you think about. All true doctrine starts in Torah and expands from there. It does. If it starts just in the New Testament by itself, you're dealing with half the story and half the definition. It has to go from the foundation forward. And the Bible, the Apostle Paul tells us, Jesus is the goal of the Torah. He's the goal. He's the bullseye that when the Torah does its job, it brings you to Jesus and helps you clarify who Jesus is, what he's going to do in your life, and what he's going to empower you to do. It was all about getting you there. My goodness, we need to change our attitudes. We need to start being people of this book once again. Do you know what? The Bible says that we're supposed to make the Jews jealous. And I've heard a lot of theories over the years about that. How many know that you cannot make enough money to make a Jew jealous? I've actually heard people say that. God's going to make every Christian a millionaire, and it's going to make the Jews jealous. Hogwash. I've already seen what makes a Jew jealous when I was over in Germany in the military. The fire of the Holy Spirit. And when that fire begins to cause you to be able to do the commandments of God, because you love God and God is empowering you to do it, it will prick his heart to jealousy and he'll realize who Messiah is. That's how important Moses and the Torah is in end times and where we are now. It's time for us to wake up to that fact. Well, Father, we've covered a lot in this session. Father, and it's just really scratching the surface of Moses, the law, and the kingdom. But Father, I ask that you would give us ears to ears that hear and eyes to see, and that the Holy Spirit would release a fresh fire on the inside of us to glorify Christ and to live the ways of God in the earth as a witness declaring that Jesus is the only way. And Father, we thank you. We praise you for it today. In Jesus' name.